Comedy has evolved throughout the years, both on stage and on screen, and particularly on the big screen. Whether it's the old silent comedies of Keaton, Chaplin, Lloyd, whether it's the golden age comedies of Billy Wilder, whether it's the 70s stuff with Monty Python, there are so many different bits of cinematic comedy, and it shows great range, diversity of humour and tastes. However, incredibly underrated example of postmodern comedy is 2007's Mr. Bean's Holiday, which is a cinematic masterpiece. And in this video, I'm going to go in great detail explaining why this is peak cinema. I should also clarify that we have a storm tonight, so there may be a few technical hitches in this video, and also I'm working on a bit of a deadline here. So if there are any technical glitches throughout the video, you've been warned, it might happen, but it'll probably go smoothly, so I'm sure there's nothing to worry about. Mr. Bean's Holiday is a postmodern masterpiece. In particular, how it employs the technique of intertextuality, a text within a text, a web of texts, a madam web of texts, if you will.
He was in the Amazon with my mother when she was researching spiders
just before she died.
As a result, the film contains a plethora of pop culture references and homages that really help to form the film's identity. Mr. Bean's Holiday, that is not Madam Web. Now, I would argue you can clearly see this homage most clearly in the war section of the film, where, to really capture the brutality and the unflinching horror of war, director Steve Bendelak took heavy inspiration from a lot of different war classics, including director Steven Spielberg with his approach to showcasing the true horrors of war. And this whole sequence is a real homage to Spielberg's iconic, unflinchingly brutal war masterpiece, 1941.
Oops! I think we might have the wrong clip here.
You think? Mr. L, you're fired.
You're a tosser.
And you can't edit. Get out of here. But even beyond that, Mr. Bean's Holiday pays homage to various bits of cinema throughout history. I mean, you've got clear homages in this film to the French New Wave of cinema. You consider the influence of filmmakers like Jean-Luc Godard, François Truffaut, Jean-Pierre Melville, and you consider the stylistic influence of films like The 400 Blows. And other movies with titles that I can't be bothered to learn the pronunciation of because I'm British and I don't give a toss about the rest of the world now, do I? You know, I really hope at this point people have realised this video is a complete joke and they don't take what I'm saying as gospel. It's the internet, Dan. What else are people gonna do? Come on. Oh well, at least I'm not on Twitter. The film also pays a lot of homage to the iconic comic master that we all know as Buster Keaton. Specifically, it pays homage to his 1928 masterwork, The Cameraman. The parallels, you see, Buster Keaton in that movie was a cameraman, Mr. Bean is a cameraman, and I am also a cameraman. Well, more of a photographer, but that's besides the point. These two, Mr. Bean and Buster Keaton, they are my literally me characters. They are literally me. These are the characters that I relate to the most. Yeah, screw Travis Bickle or Patrick Batman or whoever Ryan Gosling was in Drive. Yeah, screw them sad pricks. I mean, what's so relatable about those guys? I mean, they ain't got any riz. But Mr. Bean has riz, okay? He does. Want more homages? Well, here's the clue. This movie came out in 2007, and it features a train. Now, what other movie from 2007 features a train? That is right, Wes Bloody Anderson's The Darjeeling Limited. Now, obviously, The Darjeeling Limited was heavily inspired by Mr. Bean's Holiday, and that shows how Mr. Bean's Holiday has had a lasting impact on cinema in the past nearly 20 years. But a bigger influence on Wes Anderson's career was in this deleted scene that I've managed to get access to from raiding Wes Anderson's house. Sorry, politely asking him. This deleted scene from the Grand Budapest Hotel shows heavy influence from Mr. Bean's Holiday.
Oh, I got a funny feeling when she walks in the room. Yeah, and I, as I recall it, ended much too soon. Oh, what a night.
Louise, where'd you come from?
My mother's womb. Now, I would like to talk about my song. Specifically, not being on the record like it was promised. And I was also promised 20% shares in all record sales.
Okay. What's that got to do with me?
Well, it has a fat lot to do with you, since you're the bloody manager of this record company, so do the right thing, sir. Re-release the album with my song intact on there. As opposed to constantly favouring that talentless and no-good Charlie Diamond.
I'll be candid with you, sonny. Charlie's a great kid. You ain't given me anything to note in like 6 years. I mean, you're just a big fat phony. All these lazy cover songs, all these stupid costumes you're coming with. It all just distracts from the fact that you've got no talent, no personality, nothing. You're just a pathetic, washed-up, shallow, no-good piece of...
You know, I never believed I'd ever get this far. In my singing career, of course. Not this fiasco. Now, how am I going to sort all this out? Oh, hello, Dolly. I can explain. This isn't what it looks like.
Hey guys, what's up? It's Joe the Filmbro here, back with another video, and today is a very special day because I am finally, after 8 years of doing videos, I have now hit 20 whole subscribers. So I gotta thank all of you, including my mom, my buddy Gregory from math class, and my grandpa's hustler friend from Texas. So in honor of this incredible milestone, I am gonna be sharing with you guys my top 4 on Letterboxd. So let's go! Okay, number 1, an obvious pick, American Psycho, you know, we're the best movie ever made. I'm gonna go Pulp Fiction, you know, I love Tarantino movies, like, I love them. I'll go Fight Club, you know, beating the crap out of people is perfectly okay. And I'll throw an oddball in there. I'll go Joker, you know, it's a great movie. The best movie I've ever seen in my life. See, I'm not like other guys. I don't have any of that Ryan Gosling crap on there, that crap head, because I have got more riz than he will ever have in his lifetime. So with all that said, subscribe.
Why do I keep doing this? Oh well, I'll watch Barbie now.
I don't just care.
You see, I won this Oscar for Best Supporting Actor in Road to the Multiverse. It was an Academy Award winning performance, that was.
It was here in the summer of 1976 where Lewis Gilbert and his film crew descended to film the latest James Bond outing, 1977's The Spy Who Loved Me. And it was on this very pond that Sir Roger Moore, the late great Sir Roger Moore, filmed an infamous jet ski scene. Unfortunately, that scene was left on the cutting room floor. And it was on this very bench where the late great Sir Roger Moore and Barbara Bach consummated their love.
Don't be sounding this crap, man. It's propaganda.
Billy, what the f***ing hell are you doing? You're looking right now, you cheat. You just don't think.
Hey,
let's break it up,
hey, Robbie. I'll have a chat to Ben. It's Billy Major.
Shut up.
Yeah, shut up, you dick.
No, you shut up, you dick.
What?
What? You stupid arsehole. I never
liked you! Lads! Mr. Pizzies! Twat, so we can film here.
Oh! There's a pigeon.
Nah, screw this. This video, I give up.
Boy, I am sick to death of these blinging thunder storms we've been having recently. I can't believe what's actually happened. No, Dan, before you say anything, what in God's name happened to your voice? I reckon what's happened is that you got absolutely hammered last night and then you woke up with another accent. You know that woman on the telly who she woke up with a Geordie accent after a night out? You remember? Brian, you know full well what happened. You were with me in cricket not even 20 minutes ago. You saw that it was the bleeding thunderstorms that have caused all this hoo-ha. So can you please, just for once in your life, not talk out of your arse, all right?
Whoa, hang on. Hold the phone, pal, the car, pal.
What?
Cricket, is it? You've just been with Cricket, the drug dealer from down the road?
I was never there.
Wait a second. Has he got your voice?
Of course. Just had to be the pensioner.
In a white room with black curtains near the station. Black roof country.